Welcome everybody back here to your coverage of the RaidCall EMS One Summer Group Stage. That's right, the heat is on, and actually it's quite nice. I've had the air on, the cool air on, because you know what's getting a little bit hot in here. Quantic versus Imaginary Gaming, French versus French, if you can really call it that with Quantic Lamp, because they do have a Russian as well as a Ukrainian in their roster. But either way we look at it, it's the all French matchup, so we are going to get ourselves a little bit cultured. And the man who knows everything about culture, because he's from America, is the capitalist.
And you know why it's getting so hot in her, right, Toby? Because you're casting with me.
Yeah, I can take that as a legitimate reason. I can go with that, man. I can go with that.
I agree.
It could also be because I've got awesome Dota and I see a Meepo as the second ban. Could also be another reason.
Nah, it's me. Aquatic versus Imaginary Gaming. Alright. I did some exercise between games. I fell out of it. I was completely out of it game one. I knew it. Like you said, I had no idea we were going to Quantic versus Imaginary Gaming. No idea. Yeah. Sitting there in the wrong game going, where's Toby?
It was the original plan, man. The original plan was actually we cast Quantic versus Imaginary Gaming at the same starting time as the other one, and Shiva would cast the other game. And then, that didn't happen because there was a 1 hour delay on this game. So, we ended up just casting the first game of Flipside. And then jumped ourselves over to this one as we was going to do at the very, very start. And Shiva is going to be cast in the other game. So if you're still looking to see the boys Flipside and Natolic RU play, definitely check out Shiva's live stream. She will be over there casting that one. So big shout out to Shiva as well. Make sure you watch her stream. Watch both streams, peoples. Got support. Support all those English viewers out there. The more viewers, the merrier. That's the reason why we managed to crack about 140,000 people during DreamHack, because we had two English live streams going. It was all about the peoples, man.
People are always like, oh, they act like you can only watch one stream at a time. Most of the time, the games are actually going on, like, back and forth. Usually, like, one game ends, and there's a break, and you go check out the other stream. Like, you have them both up at the same time. Mm-hmm. But this game, Nyx Assassin, Keeper of Light, picked up by Imaginary Gaming, Batrider, and Lone Druid. Love seeing the bear in the pool. Can't get enough of that hero. But Imaginary Gaming, they have some really strong early game. But Quantic, with the offlaners that they have, Batrider being able to jungle, Lone Druid being able to go in the offlane here, just because Imaginary Gaming can go in aggressive tri-lane doesn't necessarily mean that they're going to have a winning laning phase. Like, yes, Nyx Assassin, Keeper Light, very strong combo together, outputs a lot of damage. You put any sort of aggressive carry in that lane, your Lifestealers, your Gyrocopters, or any sort of hero that outputs some damage, you're going to assure yourself some easy kills. But that being said, with that Lone Druid pickup, that means they can either do a defensive tri-lane with Lone Druid going up against an aggro, or they can put him in the offlane, and 1v1, Lone Druid pretty much wins almost every single matchup. There are very few heroes who can stand up against Lone Druid 1v1.
Well, unless you have an Odia or a Lifestealer, at which point you can stand that 1v1, man. You can stand that 1v1, but OD taken out, Lifestealer still in the pool right now. And I love, too, like our question from our previous game, like, what do you really love seeing here in the draft? I got my wish, man. I got my Enabler. I got my Keeper of the Light. I'm really happy with that one. I am still trying to work out if Quantic are just screwing around a little bit with a Tinker and Meepo ban. Tinker, obviously, you can ban him out. It's quite a legitimate thing. In the first two, we hardly ever see it. But the Meepo ban, that's a little bit more left-wing. I know there is not a single person on Imaginary Gaming that plays a Meepo. And I know that because I've watched Imaginary Gaming play many, 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 many times. Be it through the Big Point Battles, be it through the ISO Cups, be it through ESWC, be it through all these different events. The defense qualifiers, I saw them there too. Yeah. They're a team that definitely does not play Meepo. But what they can do with this lineup, stick it to the man on the top. Give a nice little range damager up on that top. And we're going to see Magnus. Man, how long has it been since we have really got to... I actually can't remember. I cannot. It at least has been over 2 weeks since I've cast a Magnus game.
Yeah. And on top of that, I mean, the last time you saw him mid, too, that's even farther back. We've seen him picked up for the offlane much more often now. And, I mean, to me, that says I really would not want to run. Even if it's in his safe lane, I wouldn't want to run Magnus versus the Lone Druid. So they're either going to be throwing him mid here, taking back that role for the Magnus, or they're just planning on running a defensive try and throw Magnus in the off lane just as sacrifice, trying to get level 6 and maybe a blink dagger somewhere in there. But this might be just a sack Magnus picked up. Meanwhile, I'm a little bit surprised that Lifestealer is still actually left in the pool. Quantic Gaming, they could have banned that one out. Instead, they banned out the Templar Assassin, the Darkseer. All very strong heroes to be going up against. Templar Assassin, obviously, they don't want to deal with that. But with this, if they were planning on picking up the Slark, honestly, I'd be fine with Templar Assassin being in the pool. I thought they were going to pick up some other mid just because of the fact that they banned her out. But now they've got the Slark that can blow through those refractions really quickly and the Firefly. But maybe that's just some peripheral presence, and that's going to be a defensive try lane there. The Cancer Lancer is back, baby.
Well, I'm hoping it's still aggressive, man. I'm hoping it's still aggressive. But you are right. It is looking to be a rather defensive try lane. And Quantic, well, they're going to be a little bit frustrated with this one. They grabbed the Rubik, so at least they got possibilities of some nice steals, be it Luminate, be it the Magnus RP, which will definitely be the one, the highest on the list of things to grab. But with a Batrider, a Lone Druid, and a Slark, this is such a momentum-based game, man. This is such a momentum-based game. You've already got the Batrider. You can sack the bottom lane if you want to, but you can also try and contest it if you also wish to. And with the Rubik already being picked up too, easy support, easy leveling up. They take out the Visage as well. A little bit worried about Quantic also coming out. The blocks are hitting very, very hard. Magnus is going to have a horrible time in mid. Absolutely horrible time against Slark. The Essence Shift is going to destroy off that Magnus very, very quickly. And if Slark is able to get the upper hand, which you kind of know is going to happen once he pops that level 2, then Magnus is dead. You want to skewer yourself away? Sure, you'll be able to do that, but Slark can easily chase. Very easily chase. So the timing of the pounce with that initiation in the middle lane, I'm interested to see what's going to happen there.
Yeah, as long as Slark brings enough health regen, he should be fine in that lane, and like you said, he should be able to be very aggressive. Melee on melee, you get an early level in that Essence Shift, and it can really dominate the lane. Very, very easily for you. So look for that pickup if it is going to be a Magnus versus the Slark middle. I think it is just because of the fact that they really need some good mid-game control here. And unless they're going to pick up, you know, something like, I don't know, like a Queen of Pain, something like that, some very, very mid-game hero-based hero that has a lot of burst damage to be able to throw down on a hero like Slark. Because with the Phantom Lancer, obviously they have the late game. With Keeper of the Light, Nyx Assassin, they have the laning phase just fine. All they really need to focus on is the mid-game pushes that are going to be going on. You know Slark's going to be moving around the map trying to get those ganks off. So some counter ganking with a very highly mobile hero would be really, really important. Another hero who would be able to get away from that that pounce proc of being able to leash someone in would be very, very important. On top of that, just the burst damage in general versus a Batrider, Slark, and Rubik would be very, very strong. Imaginary Gaming, though, they're going to pick up an offlaner here, and that's going to be their Bounty Hunter pickup, which, I mean, honestly, I'm not a big fan of, just because I see them being such on the defensive that I don't feel that they're really going to be able to use track to snowball heavily. Quantic, meanwhile, you've got some decent AoE. That's the biggest problem. I really love Broodmother as a fifth pick, but it's only against a team that doesn't have enough AoE to be able to stop you.
Uh-huh. This is a ballsy pickup coming from Quantic as their last one. To go with that Broodmother? That is Godblade 2 on the Slark, so we've got to support Slark. We get a support Slark, which means I'm wondering too if that means we get a Broodmother in the middle lane. Something else we have seen in the past, but a very, very old past. Very, very old past. And also surprised to see the Bucking Mad is going to still remain on the support, even with the Broodmother in the pool. Because that's one of the heroes which I know he's played in the past. And played a lot in the past as well. So, how are we going? Are we seeing switches here? Soshka on the Broodmother? No, Bucking Mad will remain on the Rubik. But keeps Goldblack as well on the Slark at Goldblack. He's built for solo mid. So he will be going solo mid, which puts our bottom lane with Soshka down there, Rubik up on the top lane, so he must be babysitting Funzie, who'll be taking on a number one role. This time around as a lone druid. And Silent, who it's pretty obvious will just abandon the middle lane and go into the jungle. I say abandon, just give the room for Slark to do his thing. And now the movement does come. Imaginary Gaming gonna rotate up. Five heroes all together inside of smoke. They are just searching for that jungle hero. Might just be looking for the Batrider. And Batrider, he is trying to rush up the bottle very early on. And Imaginary Gaming gonna find nobody. Or will they? Bucking Mad might get very, very lucky here and rotate the right way around. The smoke, it just got revealed on Bounty Hunter. He went invis, now Bucking Mad realizes he's in so much trouble. This will be the first blood. A Lancer saw him down, only a little bit though, he's still on the run. Illuminate Blast, gonna be a lot of damage. Is there gonna be range for a Shockwave too? You can see Bandit's trying to get closer, there goes your Shockwave, it will hit. He's back in range of the Tier 1 tower, he's actually able to live through that.
Yeah, that was just really unfortunate. If Imaginary Gaming had stayed grouped up a little bit more, they would obviously would have been able to just get those stuns in. But unfortunately, Nyx's Assassin was so far out, he was never going to be able to hit a stun. And just the Lance slow by itself is never going to be enough. So they're actually in a little bit of an unfortunate position here. It looks like they're going to be going aggressive tri-lane here. And I like that idea. They wouldn't be able to shut down the Broodmother anyway. They have the counters, but it's still a hard lane to be able to just ultimately keep the Broodmother out just because of the movement with those webs. Instead, they're going to throw Bounty Hunter up against her, who can survive in lane, is going to be able to get some decent CS, and that's all this lane's going to be about.
Slark has got to get out of here. Slark has got to get out of here right now. He just saw nice points of essence, but being stunned up. He's got no jump away. There's your Illuminant. Shockwave still on cooldown. And Slark will run down to the bottom rune, which is obviously not there, but he'll up high. Shockwave still available. But it's only level 1, so it won't get the kill out in Slark. And instead, he returns in towards the middle lane. So foul gank there into the middle lane for Imaginary Gaming, but still. They're doing something about it. They're moving the Coddle. They're moving the Nyx. They're trying to find the openings on these heroes and at least make Quantic wary about what's coming out of the Fog of War.
Yeah, some good pressure. They just can't leave the Phantom Lancer alone for too long. They've got some really hot long-range nukes to be able to throw down on Funzie. So he has to play really, really careful in this lane. Just the Spirit Lance being able to be spammed constantly on, Lone Druid's a very squishy hero early on. Before level 6, he does not have a whole lot of health, and his biggest mainstay is the fact that he has a Spirit Bear who acts as pretty much a buffer. So any sort of blinking hero or long-range nukes are very, very powerful against him. So I really like this aggressive tri-lane. The two supports are going to be able to shut down Rubik's pulls, just constantly keep him from being able to... check out that Observer Ward, by the way. That is legit.
Which one are we talking about?
The one for the Radiant at top.
You're talking about this guy right here? Oh, you're talking about the design of the ward. I'm like, that's a decent ward positioning, but what else are you on about? Oh, it's the sunflower, man. It's the sunflower. Bucking Mad has rotated up to the top lane now. Just staring down Sev a little bit. He actually could do a lot of damage to Sev if he's not careful. And he actually goes for another one. Picks up the Keeper of the Light. Fade Ball is still available. That should be first blood, or should it be? The bear needs another hit. It can't get it. Jeez. The stun can be thrown out by the Spirit Bear from the next assassin to keep that Spirit Bear away.
Well, I mean, this should be a very easy lane for them to win, especially once they hit level 3. But that was really silly, almost giving up that first blood. Middle, meanwhile, looks like Magnus is doing a decent job. He's actually ahead in CS right now, probably because of that early aggression. Goblock was actually able to pick up a rune. But now, from now on out, now that he's level 4, he's just going to be able to get very, very aggressive on Magnus.
And Soshka is really living life here on the edge. He doesn't have a web up. And actually, first blood's going to be happening in the middle lane. Thought Soshka, who's the man diving on a tier 1 tower with no web up, would be the first one to go down. But hey, guess missing first blood. I wonder how many people voted for that one. And 64% of people were correct. Congratulations. But Magnus, really surprised that Goblack could actually get caught out like that. This isn't his normal role, though. That's why I'm surprised that he's here in the middle lane. Maybe he just got bored and wants to try something different.
Yeah, I don't know, because that the power of Slark is being able to aggressively harass the hero, but you can't go for a kill straight out the gate. You know, Magnus is very tanky
Firefly
hero.
Top lane. There's already a pickup with telekinesis throwing down the Nyx Assassin. He doesn't have Spy Carapace up and running. The Illuminate is on the way too. Nine stun, just trying to hold silent up with the three napalm stacks on him. You cannot stop that amount of damage coming your way. And there's a secondary set. It's over on the Keeper of the Light. They would like the PL, but he's still got Doppel Walk available to him. That's why I won't say that's the reason why he's turning around to fight up against fucking Mad, but still. 1-1 now. And again, Slark on low life here in the middle lane. Level 6 is available for Magnus too, but not enough mana to really capitalize on it.
Yeah. All the lanes that should be winning are actually losing right now. Slark with that early death, he pretty much has lost his lane completely now. Magnus is going to be able to bottle crow consistently and harass Slark down. There was an opening once he was like level 3, level 4 to really harass the Magnus early on before he can bottle grow too much and spam those shockwaves. But now that's fully in swing, he's going to be able to keep Slark down low enough that he'll never feel safe to harass Magnus again. So he has to wait till he's at least level 6, and at that point, RP is going to be up for Magnus, and he still won't be able to take him out. So you might see some early rotations out of Slark, especially against this aggressive tri lane, being very, very low level. Aggressive tri lane sets are their biggest weakness, the fact they don't have access to a pull, and because of that, you end up sharing all of your experience, you become very, very low level, which leaves an opening for the mid to be able to rotate and get some easy, easy kills. So once he's level 6, you may see him rotate, or at the very least, move around and check out some of those wards.
Nyx on the way in, gonna give us some soft screw. He's actually blocked himself in his own spider links, and with the track on him, the extra movement speed will keep up with it. I'm really enjoying Soshka's build as well. He's taken a very different approach to his bottom lane. It really required the rotation out. Looks like almost Ban's killing off. Got back in the middle lane at the same time. But the way he's approached his bottom lane is, even though he's dead, the Spirelings will be killing off this bottom tower. Even timing all the last hits to go at the right time. He went 3 web, 3 spiders. He knows the buff up to the Spiderlings. He's really exploiting it to the point where a Bounty Hunter, sure, he can get Vision up on Sasha, sure, he can kill him off, but at the same time, there is no way to stop a push of that magnitude.
Yeah. This is, with the recent buffs, their nerf, early nerf, and then the recent buff to Broodmother, they've definitely made her much more of a higher risk, high reward hero who can push down towers much faster than she used to be able to, but at the same time, there's the risk of being able to feed a lot of gold. And you've got some really good AoE coming out. For the Keeper of Light, obviously the one of the biggest ones. You've also got Magnus, who was able to pick up the Slark kill.
Looks like RP, Skewer, wow, and Shockwave being used, and Nyx Assassin just watched. Because he's got full mana. Yeah, I again missed both the times the Gold Black went down. I'm just trying to keep the image of Gold Black perfect and pristine clear for all those people out there that just love the way he drafts and plays. So you'll never see him die, peoples. You'll never see him die.
Good excuse.
Yeah, I get with
just,
it, man.
Just like Dendi has more followers because you support him, right?
Of course. I'm the reason why Dendi will always be 3,000 followers on Twitter above me.
Yep.
Remember to follow me over on Twitter, TobiWanDOTA. That way you wouldn't miss a thing, except for kills.
Bounty Hunter, he's starting to move around. Yeah. Unfortunately, though, he has no support at this top lane, but they really need to get some early track kills right away, since they did
bottom
get
lane.
Bounty Hunter the safe lane.
Keeper of Light's going to go down. Soshka, we get those last little spiderlings into him. He's got a huge army behind him. Also with Lasso, with the dust up on him, he need to slow him down. That's why the napalm, and then into the Lasso, dragging him up so they can lock him in with the spiderlings. There's no way to run out of this one. Even with Invis, it wouldn't have helped him because the Firefly was surrounding him. So now a double kill on the bottom lane for Soshka. Batrider rotates out from the jungle, finds a couple of kills, and feeling pretty good about all life and things. Meanwhile, top lane, there's an entangle up on Nyx Assassin. Rubick will go down. Bounty Hunter walking around with these tracks. There goes Nyx Assassin, so it's one for one. Funzi trying to split himself into an Alderman form and then skewer up Shockwave as well. Funzi, he will go down right now, and Godlike wants to help him out. But there's nothing he can do. He popped off his ultimate. Runs away, sure he's got a regeneration room, but there's no way he's gonna be diving on a tier 1 tower to try and save his teammates who are overextending.
Yeah, that was smart by Godblack, not attempting to help out the lone druid. He knew he was dead, and he was just gonna put himself in a potentially fatal position with that Magnus having RP up. Just way too dangerous getting close. I like the fact that they're rotating Batrider. They're with these two ganking heroes, Slark and Batrider. This is actually a really interesting strat. You know there's going to be rotations by some of these heroes to try and stop the Broodmother push, and that is a very big opening for the hero like Batrider, especially once he picks up his Blink Dagger, to be able to pick off like the Keeper of the Light or the Nyx Assassin or the Magnus.
Well, got some fun over on the side. Nyx Assassin playing around with Silence as well as Goldblack. Or Goldblack doing the same thing. Broodmother just kills secures with the Spiderlings. But it's better for her to have her army get created. And now they look over Bounty Hunter. Just to pop off. They knew where he was. Goldblack going to pounce. And that's going to hold the Bounty in position. Sun, he's got to get this. Oh, wonderful lasso. It's just only managed to stop off that RP. So Bounty will burn. And now Slark. Oh! Shockwave's gonna miss. Leap away. RP still not used. This is just not going right for the Magnus. Quantic literally running circles around them.
Yeah. That was a huge misplay there. Being able to kill the Slark again and keep him down. Like, with those two early deaths, Slark is very much needs some early stat items. He's a very squishy item. Very squishy hero going into the mid-game, once you're able to throw down some counter wards, it's very easy just to be able to pick him off. So he really needs, from that mid, to be able to pick up some early stat items and...
Soshka.
Bottom, yeah.
A level 4 Keeper of the Light will never survive up against such a thing. And also in the meantime, I don't know if you've seen, but there's a triple stack, which was created by Silent on the bigger creeps. Oh, Broodmother actually had a spree ended. Was that also using? No, RP still not used. But Silent just basically took about 1,000 gold out of the jungle of Imaginary Gaming.
Nice. Yeah. I mean, all this pressure is allowing Funzy to be able to push in this tier 1 tower. And they won't really be able to ever rotate to stop him. They have to stop this Broodmother. It's more gold for Keeper of the Light. If he ever can get a good blast and pick up a lot of those spiders, that's going to be a huge influx of gold for him. On top of that, Broodmother pushes this lane faster, so it's just going to be up to, I guess, the Bounty Hunter is going to try and man fight Funzy a little bit, keep him from being able to take this tier 1 tower too early.
That was actually really unlucky for Sky on the top lane. He was bringing down the bear, and he had the bear about maybe 10-15 HP, and then one of the creeps killed it off.
Oh.
So there was no bonus gold coming from killing off the bear. That's 300 gold that goes down the drain because he was just short of 15 damage. It can be very, very frustrating for him. But Funzy has managed to resummon his bear and they'll be very much aware of this. That's why Nyx is already on the hunt. And Funzy is already falling back. As far out as possible. And actually, Vlad too far up now. He doesn't have Vendetta to escape from this. If he gets spotted... it can very easily go down because Funzy's grouped up with the rest of his teammates. Bottom lane, Soshka wants to go again. Goldblack gonna leave himself down, unable to actually get that leash on the Keeper of the Light, but Soshka already with an insatiable hunger. Goldblack, one lance, there he goes. It's a one for one trade, diving on tier 2 towers to get these kills. But it is keeping distraction away from that middle lane. Not completely, but it's working.
Yeah. Blink Dagger's gonna be
nice! RP from Bands gonna skewer back Shockwave and the Nyx Stump through the double. Not just the double, but also the bear. If they can keep this attack going on the bear and they get this bear back on the cooldown, they've got to keep the damage going. Return, there it is. Funzy able to get him out of the sight using the trees for the Fog of War.
Oh, Goblack. I mean, just now picking up Power Treads, that's it. That's all he has. So Imaginary Gaming, even though I really like this strategy from Quantic, it's obviously going to take a little bit buffering, but it's a really good idea, their strategy. Unfortunately, Imaginary Gaming, oh nice, great telekinesis by Buckingmad.
Hold him out, put that skewer up too now, Buckingmad's going to get himself out of here. In fact, he'll skewer one of the fake ones away, plus the Shuri tossed it. P.O. won't give it up, around the corner, Blink, oh, Bans is caught. He's caught in the tree line, last two to go off from Sun. Dragging that bounty and back in range of that tier 2 tower. However, still an invis. Can't see him, no gem to reveal. So just Fireflies up the middle lane. And Sky runs away as fast as possible. But there goes tier 2 tower in bottom lane.
You can never take your eye off of this Broodmother. Oh, there it is. First time that a little bit of gold goes down, Blink Dagger is picked up on the Magnus, and he's able to only initiate really well, but...
Shuri toss, Lance, right behind him, the track is still up, And there's four heroes together to gank that one up with a level one track. So, not a huge bonus gold, but still 150 plus, 50 gold for each one of the supporting heroes. And 150 gold as well that goes away with the bounty hunter. Yeah. Oh, Bucky Mad, solo kill. He stole Chakra. That wasn't what he was searching for, but it'll work. And now, Slark, he's gonna jump. Didn't get the leash. Blink, Skewer, actually gonna work out nicer, or will it? Skewer's in with three men RP, Bears included. Slark, follow up there with a Nyx stun, so double on that stun. And Funzy just had to TP back out again. But now he's out of the big problem. Bear to be lost, that's 300 gold. He evades, no he doesn't. 1 second, and now he gets it out. I'll send that bear back to heal.
He is keeping imaginary gaming in this game. I mean, honestly, this early aggression where Quantic, with this Broodmother, they're controlling the jungle. They're making sure they're not feeding too many spiders. They're controlling the jungle really, really well, putting pressure on this lane to make sure Phantom Lancer never gets farmed. And when they rotate, that gives opportunity for the two gankers to be able to pick off some easy, easy kills. It's a really, really excellent strategy with a lot of synergy with this Broodmother. Unfortunately, Ban's just hitting those big RPs, completely turning this game in their favor.
That's really good money with an Illuminate through the spiderlings. It's all been scouted out by the bounty hunter. But it looks like Soshka, he's going to be calling out to go for Roshan shortly. Yep, there you go. Sentry Wars preparation. They got a double damage rune and a Broodmother who has insatiable hunger. This is exactly what they want. A small little army of spiderlings. And Roshan won't last long. And I don't believe Imaginary Gaming can or should do anything about this. The PL is still farming up on that top lane. If he comes in to try and fight this one, there's going to be a high possibility that the initiation for Imaginary Gaming is just going to get choked up in the Firefly. The Mag RP will be great, but Mag RP is down for another 14 seconds. And it's just not enough time. There goes Roshan. Aegis the Immortal Ghost, the Lone Druid.
He's going to be trying to go for that Radiance pickup.
Blink Lasso. Dust as well. He's just starting up with the Napalm with the Firefly as well. Got to get more of these stacks up before he's going to lasso him. And making the most out of that. Wow, actually even just holding the lasso the entire time. Very conservative. Napalm, very nicely done. Middle lane. Aegis already lost. That wasn't part of the plan for Quantic. RP still available, Skewer, however, not Funzy, can't get ulti form. He goes down, leaves his bears not on cooldown, but Aegis Immortal is instantly lost.
Lone Druid is
silent. Haste rune, he wants the lance, he got it. And then RP catches three bans. He's been 100% in the money for this. This is what happens. This is the reason why people love playing the Magnus over and over again. If you even feel slightly behind, or if someone's even like weirdly out of position, you just get those beautiful RPs. And maybe it's just because Quantic hasn't played up against Magnus for such a long time, they've really gotten a little bit lapsed there on their positioning to evade that RP.
Unfortunately, Aegis is not a very strong pickup for Lone Druid. He's one of the weaker Aegis heroes, but he was only going to be strong once he picked up the Radiance and they forced a five-man team fight, because he goes down, his bear is still alive, and it's still doing a lot of burn damage.
Funzy's dead.
Middle, though.
Bucky Mad's in here as well. They could lose two right now. Blink, Skewer back, and that will be actually the death of the Lone Druid. Imaginary Gaming, they really, really, really want to win this. They know if they can win this game, they get themselves into the winner's bracket final. If they win that, they go to Poland. It's that simple. Pick up, throw down. Sun's already dead. 20-10. And Quantic, the runners-up of DreamHack Summer, are in a horrible, horrible position. Nice stun to be stolen by Bucky Mab. They can easily clean up the creep waves now.
I mean, so much of Dota is like a psychological game, and Imaginary Gaming, they played that so beautifully, right? They went in, got the gank. First gank, okay. That's fine. Quantic Gaming, they assume that, you know, Imaginary Gaming with that pickoff and with the Phantom Lancer, they're going to back off, they're going to try and get some farm, but no, Imaginary Gaming, they just kept that up, that aggression, man, and played out beautifully for them. Now they're going to be able to pick up a tier 2 because of that. Phantom Lancer is going to be able to pick up a nice early Manta, which is going to be huge, because that allows him to be able to farm this bottom lane up against Broodmother, who picked up a very, very early Orchid. Pretty much once the Orchid was picked up, it shut off that lane completely for Phantom Lancer to be able to farm, but once he has Manta, he can turn that around.
Mm-hmm. Which means now Sasha's got to find a different target to beat down on. And I'm pretty sure he'll be looking at the Keeper of the Light, but Keeper of the Light also with four stars, so can make some space between himself as well as the Broodmother. It was always one of those older problems of a Broodmother, that high movement speed. You only get it inside the webs, and oh wow, Silent. Fireflies, the stuff's already been popped off. Shuri tossed to get the kill from Bounty, and he got the track off in time. Meanwhile though, Rubik, out to pick up the Bounty Hunter. He still had that extra stun up his sleeve. So it becomes a one-for-one trade. Not a bad trade to have, but what they really want is that Magnus. He is 4-0 with 10 assists, man. This yeah. Magnus has to die for Quantic to have a chance, but now he's got the BKB up, and with the extra farm he just got in the middle lane, up with 1,000 bonus gold. It's just a rough time, and Soshka, even if he wants to push out this bottom lane, it's such a risky thing for him to do. Funzi was farming up inside the jungle, and Soshka, he's got to hide in his invis. The pings are already coming off there from Magnus, saying, just make sure you know, this isn't working too well. Sentry warded up. Let's see if we can find him, huh?
Yeah, that was really well done by Sasha. He threw one little spider and got vision of that upcoming gank. Sasha, he's working on his BKB, but even at this point, with the physical damage coming out from that Phantom Lancer, he's soon going to be able to, you know, spawn that army of his, and he's actually going to be able to contest on Broodmother's pushes just by being able to, you know, create his own army and just push it through. So they're really getting very, very limited on their time where they can use this Broodmother effectively. Now, she can come into team fights.
Bounty, now's the time to pick him up. Where's the pickup? There's a lasso. They dropped a sentry ward as well. Follows up with a stun. RP only going to pick up Soshka. Now RP stolen by Bucking Mad. He used it, holds him in position. So Soshka, he's got time to attack. Skewer up, try to force him away. Then the TP out. The flame break. The BKB wore off. The BKB wore off while he's trying to TP out. 3 euros lost for Imaginary Gaming. The Lancers will fly the way of Silent. Just have a quick flame break. Try and split him out again. But that was the fight the Quantic Gaming were waiting for. The stolen RP and the horrible choke point for Imaginary Gaming.
And it's no surprise that the first time that Bans does not hit that big, big RP, they don't win the fight. They lose it horribly. But he's given Phantom Lancer enough time that even if Quantic is able to win some team fights and push in towers, Phantom Lancer is going to be able to pick up his farm, and by the time they're ready to crack open the base, Phantom Lancer will be that big force. He's going to probably pick up a very casual Vit booster here, try and work into Heart, that way he has some tankiness, but he's got his main damage dealing and team fighting items, Diffusal and Mantis style. He can contest the Broodmother as much as he wants, and also be able to participate in some of these team fights as long as he stays back.
Just to point out how much was lost during the last couple of minutes. It's only been over the course of the last 3 to 4 minutes, but an advantage that was 5,000 gold.
Bottom.
Bottom? Yeah, it's Soshka. Spy Carapace, one way to hold him there. But the Spyling Army continues to fight on, almost with a surround, but they're chasing down the Nyx Assassin. Support's on the way, Batrider's coming in. And he might look to the Bounty Hunter, but then again, all these Spylings, they're starting to be fed. And there's Blink, Dust, pulling back in again. The Spylings can start doing that little thing. Napalm. Got to keep that vision going, though. This time around, Silent hasn't just baited it out. But with the Spylings, going to block him in there. They get the kill. Bounty goes down for the price of the Broodmother. And Broodmother, well, he already picked up his BKB, so he won't be too sad.
Really nicely done. We're getting to the point where Magnus is going to start building into almost like a semi-carry build. With the farm he's gotten, he already has his Blink Dagger BKB. Now, he can opt to go for a refresher here.
Gall Black, Leap. Pounce, 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 pounce. He can, yeah. Gem up for either side. They know what's going on. Whoa! RP just off to the side. That was actually Bucky Mad trying to cast that one. And now you'll have to steal Shockwave instead. Returns it. Magnus pops off the BKB. He's still searching for the Slark. He'll have to settle for Bucky Mad, but telling his pickup. There goes your RP. Holding Slark in position. Follow-up stun with the Illuminate. Gem's now going to be dropped by Quantic. They lose both their support players in their bottom lane.
And they just gave Imaginary Gaming that gem back, so Broodmother's going to have to play very, very careful now.
Well, that's actually now two gems for Imaginary.
Yeah. That's the problem with Broodmother, is that while she is extremely good at dominating one lane, she needs certain items. She needs BKB most effectively. But even then, once she rotates out of her one lane, she is not very good at being able to participate in these team fights, and that's really going to start to show. All of that farm being picked up on that hero, it's all not going to be really going effectively in these team fights. So, Lone Druid, you saw he went for Maelstrom instead of his Radiance because he couldn't farm it up in time. But once he has his Mjolnir, that's going to be a lot of damage coming out, and they have to fight at that point.
Sashka, he's going to give this a crack. Who's going to actually orc it up? BKB pops up from Sashka, and he just man-fires up against Spider. And he does get that kill. But then again, in through the rear, looks like Bucky Mag got himself caught out, and Soshka's looking for the next target. That bite really just messing up with the PL, but at the same time, Sashka tracks up on him. He's going to go down. Blink Lasso. That'll bring the Nyx Assassin in range of the Tier 2 tower. Spy Carapace not making it easy to get that kill out, especially when Goldback's trying to do his work. Blink away, going to evade the attack of the tower, and now Sev, there's just too much of him. Starting to replicate up on that bottom lane. They will take this Tier 2 tower. At the same time, top lane, Lone Druid loses his bear, has to resummon once he got back. But Magnus denies off the Tier 1 tower on the top lane while the Tier 2 tower does go down now.
Yeah, that was, I mean, they didn't even take the Tier 1 tower. That was obviously an awful trade there, but Lone Druid, he's got his, he's still going for it. He went for an early Maelstrom here, but now it looks like he's still going to go for that Radiance. The problem is, he needed to be able to pick that up really, really early. That way, that team fight damage would really be able to help keep the Phantom Lancer at bay. But at this point, Phantom Lancer, he almost has his hearts already. He's going to be a major force in these team fights, and even if they lock him down with, like, the Batrider being able to grab him with Lasso and focus him down with the Bear, you're still going to have a very, very hard time because that sets you up for really easy RP.
Mm-hmm.
So it's either they get initiated on by the Magnus or they get counter-initiated on. Either one, they're going to end up losing the team fight. So they're going to need some really good positioning in this next team fight. And after that, just go straight for the throat. I don't think they can take this much later.
I don't think so either, man. Trouble middle lane. That's locked dead. Track, stun, nice leap. Mana Burn will be there as well, but you know he's going to heal up pretty quickly, and Mana Burn just stolen by Bucking Mad. 28 to 16. And this advantage, Imaginary Gaming got it back again. Whatever they lost, they got back. They will roll with the punches, but they're still going to be concerned. Four staffs coming up for Batrider. He's only about 400 gold away from having such a thing. It's like Slugger's trying to build himself into a BKB. Rubick just has nothing apart from what he steals. And now with that hard up on PL, like as you're saying, it's going to be difficult to get through, and Slark, he's going to run. Bucky Map doesn't have a TP scroll. He's trying to fight this one. Oh, he walked in! Close enough for the RP to hit. Bans just found himself a little bit of a gift. Sitting in the tree line.
Easy pickoffs, man. Imaginary Gaming, they're going to be able to take Roshan now with a 40-second cool death timer on Slark. And they know Funzie is still trying to work on his Radiance. He hasn't shown up with that yet, so that's just an easy rush for them to be able to pick up. And at that point, like, honestly, they can't let Bear get back into the game too much, so I wouldn't be surprised if Imaginary Gaming, they just go for a push, a five-man push, try and use that Aegis advantage as much as they can, and,
One blinks up into Vendetta to have a bit of a look. The other one blinks up to Skewer, also have a look for Silent. I think he might be attempting a steal. But you are right, Belly, that Radiant Spare, this is going to be the strat right now of Quantic. They look at this, and they say, well, okay, five-man, it's going to come from Imaginary Gaming. If we can hold it out, the split push will win. The push of the Spiderlings on that bottom lane is more than enough to help bring down that Tier 3 tower, which is on low life. And then you add a Radiant's Bear into that, it could help hold out that middle lane. Maybe if Magnus doesn't want to throw the BKB out early too, we'll interrupt his blink. But it could also just be sent towards that top lane and start its own split push. So both top lane and bottom lane will push in so hard that every single time Imaginary Gaming want to fight, they'll be forced to come back. And it's exactly what's happened. Like, you see Keeper of the Light. He's the one easiest hero they can send back to that bottom lane to defend. They need his Illuminate to hold off against the spiders. In quite a similar way, the way you got to actually send someone like Keeper of the Light back to defend up against a Phantom Lancer. It's the same scenario. And PL's army, its momentum it gains, it does get burnt out by the SB. The only thing Quantic have to make sure they do is don't get dead. If they get caught out and the fight becomes a 5v4, their split push goes to us because they need to pull everybody back to make sure they hold their racks. If they lose racks, this plan goes also down the drain. Because the Spiderling army won't be enough and the Radiant Burn also won't be enough to gain enough momentum that will force Imaginary Gaming to move back. And they found one. They found Silent. The track is up. The Spy Carapace Stun will hold Silent there. And that's what's called being dead. And that's what's called a 5v4 push.
Another thing that's really going to hurt is Phantom Lancer. When he picks up Boots of Travel, he can actually just teleport down to the bottom lane and basically create an illusion army and then have it push in that lane and then just get recalled by Keeper of the Light right back into the team fight.
Yep.
It's another powerful... It's reason why Phantom Lancer and Keeper of the Light, it's another powerful combo of theirs. It's not only just the laning phase, but also going into the mid to late game. Being able to move the Phantom Lancer around the map is so key.
Pushing out, coming in. Nice entangle up on the PL. They're going to drop him down a little bit longer than that, though. Blink to RP. Catching out two. Nice telekinesis. Also, Shockwave. The only thing to be stolen from that one. Fonzie able to get his bear back out to safety. And Soshka taking huge amounts of damage, even with the Insatiable Hunger. He couldn't get a kill out from the Nyx Assassin. And he couldn't keep himself alive. The bottom lane was trying to push in, but the Spiderling army's already gone down. Imaginary Gaming, their push is just so much stronger. And then, Illuminate lands, able to get the kill. Fucking Matt on the sideline. Found him to drag back in range to the tier 4 towers, but there's still a couple of PL illusions there. Helped Matt a little bit more, and then jump in. What, we got to skewer away, try and pull the bear out? It's not dead just yet. And Sev also hasn't managed to bring down the racks. Batrider and Goldblack, they're on the hunt. They're looking for kills. They can't see Zev, though. And they've got to get rid of these illusions. They're screwing around with them in their middle lane. But the Rax is held by Quantic, even after losing that Broodmother so early on.
Yeah. They're just going to have to, they still didn't lose Aegis because of that, so they just wait for the Magnus to be able to come back. RP or no RP, they're still going to be able to take the Rax fairly soon, just being able to throw Phantom Lancer at them pretty much with the Manta and the Illusion Army. Mm-hmm. He's going to be able to put so much physical damage so quickly that they won't be able to stop him in time. And he dies, he just comes back with the Aegis, and then they can back up, just focus on farming a little bit longer. You're going to see things like Butterfly picked up on Phantom Lancer, and he's soon going to be pretty much unkillable.
Funzie. Already TPing out. Realizes he can't stand, so he just leaves. I'm actually looking right now to see if Rubik is capable of stealing Empower. Because if Bucking Man can steal the Empower off the Magnus, which is a really rough ability to steal because most of the time it's just a prep ability. But if he can steal that Empower, he can give what is needed to Slark, to Lone Druid, to the Broodmother, to clean off these armies of PLs they're coming in. Like, it's already looking pretty damn good. Slark's able basically to Dark Pact. Clean up that creep wave as quickly as possible. And then just push it out as far as possible as well. And this bottom lane, I haven't seen it for the last 20 minutes come back over the line of the jungle. Oh, Funzie! Out way too far. Try and force stop him away. Silent comes in with a Firefly. And then actually the blinding light pushed him up to the high ground so he can escape. Rubik did go down. RP over on the side. And that's going to actually be the Slark taking a fall. Two heroes on the sidelines. And a PL army ready to push in. The Firefly is down, so the illusions are there. Actually, Firefly now wore off. This is now just an easy jump in. They will take the mid rack. Soshka, BKB. Orchid up on the Nyx Assassin. The Rax already goes down, and Broodmother just runs in, tries to pull the Creep Aggro up, as well as take the rest of the players with him. Diffuser Blade lands, and kill already for the PL. This is going to be mid Rax, to be bottom Rax, or it could just be the GG out. They're going to play out to the last, though. Silent Lasso up, able to kill up the Nyx Assassin, but Diffuser Blade again, even the Magnus, he's entangled up by the bear, but it's not going to matter. Once the bear goes down, which it will do after one little forced after an attack, the bear's on the sidelines. Lone Druid forced to resummon it. They'll give it one last shot. They need a telekinesis pickup. Not really there. This is just getting really difficult to impossible for Quanta to come back from.
Yeah. You know, it's bad when, like, the supports have Link Daggers and Shivas like Nyx Assassin does. So, Quantic, they just have to see if they can pick somebody off and make that snowball from there. And hopefully that'll allow the Broodmother to be able to take one of those tier 3 towers, maybe even a Rax. But honestly, like, it's the strategy of Broodmother is that it's a last resort of bringing her into the team fight. Bringing her into the team fight with her BKB, she's still not very effective. It's pretty much a last resort of teams when they do that. It's basically, okay, you're getting to a point where it's too late in the game where you can actually split push, and it's a better trade-off. And with almost 20,000 gold lead, over a 10,000 experience lead, and a hard carry like Phantom Lancer, I don't see any way for Quantic to be able to come back into this game. But there's always, you can always come back into a game with Lone Druid, I guess.
Nothing like a
12-slot hero.
The 12-slot Lone Druid makes anything possible, especially if you could find pickoffs just like this. Slark try and chase down, but then realizes, you know what, support's going to be coming in. Pounces away, of course, at the right time. The blink already came, but track, Shuri toss, mini stun, silent, into his firefly, and throws down the napalm. It's just meant as a deterrent, it's not meant as an initiation. And he pops off the invis rune. I think he also feels the fact that Nyx Assassin's around here. Yeah, there goes the pings out. They realize that something is wrong. And Quantic, they're just going to try and hide inside their base while the Spiderling army still, again, does its work on the bottom. Lone Druid had to bring his bear back in the middle lane. There was no option for this one. Was that a BKB? Silent. Caught out. The BKB, it was of the Bounty Hunter that got sent out. And what got stolen? Track. Nice ability. Better ability is NRP. Used on so much of the Quantic lineup. Funzie's down. That's GG. There's no one left to defend this. Broodmother is on the bottom lane. There is no way to win this game anymore for Quantic. This is just going to be Imaginary Gaming finishing up. This is a best of three matchup. The winner of the best of three will advance through into the grand final tonight. And the winner of that is going to Poland to play in the RaidCall EMS One Finals.
I mean, really well done. I still think that Quantic had a really strong strategy. If they polished up their execution a little bit better, I think they really had this game in the bag. Imaginary Gaming losing their laning phase like this, and then just the mid-game dominance of Quantic, I think they had a really good shot at pretty much being able to control the map, split push down both of those lanes, get some really early gold off of that, and just have such a gold advantage that Phantom Lancer would never really matter, no matter how long this game went in. Unfortunately, bans, man, with those RPs.
Mm-hmm.
He pretty much saved Imaginary Gaming. They lost the early game, I felt, pretty hard. Harder than they should have, especially that tri-lane. But he held his team into that game with those RPs. Beautifully done every single time.
That it was, man. That it was. Alright, guys, we're going to have ourselves a short break and be back here in a couple moments' time. Game number 2 of Quantic going up against Imaginary Gaming will be yours shortly.